Hi, and welcome to this week's Take a Break, Have a Chit Chat show. This is your weekly business success show where myself, Jenny, and Claire share business hints and tips. I share updates on Google Plus and all things Google, as well as other business success tips. Claire talks to us about our money, which is very important, and Jenny talks to us about books and the importance of being an author and how to promote your books as well. We are hoping today that we have two guests coming to join us who are not actually, as in guests with a pre-arranged, they're coming on as guests, but two people who said they would love to come in and join us live and maybe share some hints and tips with you, maybe ask us some questions. So look out for a few more people to arrive in a little while. I'm Carol Dodsley, better known to a lot of people as the how-to girl, and more recently, the G Plus how-to girl, and the girl to go to when you want to learn about all things Google Plus and Google Hangouts. And we have Claire Turner Marshall. Claire, come and say hello. You're muted. Right, Claire is frozen. I can look blank. Who's back?
You would have let me unmute. Hi, everybody. Good evening. I hope you've had a fabulous day.
And we have Jenny Braithwaite.
Good afternoon, everybody. I've actually got some sunshine in Cumbria today, which is lovely.
Cool stuff. Okay, so I'm going to kick off with the latest Google Plus updates. And this week was quite exciting because a lot of people who have a website out there have a website that they have WordPress on. And I've been playing with Blogger quite a bit, which I know Jenny used years ago before I'd even heard of blogging or anything like that. And Blogger had sort of was all the thing, and then everybody was migrating and coming away from it and going over to WordPress. But there seems to be a bit of a shift, and people are going back, or new people are coming over and talking about Blogger again. I love it. I've got my site set up over there, and the update this week is that Google Plus have now integrated that we can choose to display Google Plus comments on our Blogger website. Blogger blog is always just such a mouthful to say, so I try not to say that too much. And it's really great because this is bringing this social and linking everything together so much more. When somebody now puts a comment on your website, if you're using Blogger and you're using the G Plus comments, it means that they can actually share that post with their circles direct from your blog. So rather than somebody coming over, leaving a comment, and then maybe clicking the little link that says share on Facebook, share on Twitter, share on G Plus, or taking the URL from the top of the page and then going over and sharing it somewhere, just by putting a comment, they have the option to share directly back to their G Plus profile and choose who to share it with. So that's going to help them keep it really relevant. We have the Facebook comments that over on a WordPress blog you can integrate. And if you can hear a funny whining noise in the background, I have one baby girl here, furry baby girl, who's a little bit unhappy because her sister's been taken out for a walk and she's really not too happy. So you'll have to excuse the little whiny sounds that we're getting at the moment in the background, bless her heart. So anyway, on other blogs and on your website, you've always been able to integrate your Facebook comments, or always for quite a while. But with that, you can either share it to your page, or you could share it sometimes with a group or on your personal profile. But you couldn't choose your friends list. Who would this be relevant for? And this is one of the great things about Google Plus and Circles, is if you have your circles set up properly, you know that the people in an individual circle have an interest in a particular topic or subject area. So if people now have their comments, Google Plus comments, on their Blogger blog, and you go over, you make a comment, you can think now, who would this be really relevant to? Because of course, it's not going to be relevant to everybody. It's going to be relevant, if someone comes to mind, it's going to be relevant to small business owners and solopreneurs who want hints and tips on business success or want to know more about Google Plus, because that is my focus. So somebody could come over and think, this is great. This circle of mine are small business owners. This is going to be really relevant and add value for them, and share it just with that circle. So it's more than just, hey, you can put Google Plus comments over on your Blogger blog. Oh yeah, so what? It's comments. This is about thinking strategically and actually seeing the relevance and how you having the comments on your blog can help other people to be more relevant with the people they share with as well, and potentially moving out your visibility across the net and across Google Plus and across the internet, because of course everything is indexed. So that's my Google update for today. Claire, Jenny, anything you want to ask or say about that?
I think I'd like to say I think it's going to be something that's going to really rejuvenate Blogger, because it's something that a few years ago really was the place that people blogged. Because at one point they had Google Friends Connect, which was sort of kind of almost like a predecessor of Google Plus. It was like you could follow all the Blogger blogs using it, and like Google Plus has replaced that. So I think it's going to be very good for people who are sort of in niches where there's a big community of blogging, things like in the book blogging community where I come from and things like that. I think it's going to be a fantastic thing for that, and it's really going to get people coming back into it and using it again. And like you say, it's a great platform, but it serves a different purpose to what you may use a WordPress website for. Because I think Blogger is very much for a blog to me.
Yeah, we had a little bit of chat about this a couple of days ago, didn't we, Jenny? And Blogger, yes, mm-hmm. is about a blog. It is about creating articles and content. And a website, for some people, is about having a glossy brochure, and it depends what you want on your website. You know, I have websites that are WordPress hosted, they are membership sites. I have websites that are WordPress hosted because I need the functionality that I can't have on Blogger. For Blogger though, I think it's about telling, you know, we know that now for business success and for raising your visibility, for engaging with people, building relationships and those communities around your brand, it is vital, and for getting seen in search, which of course is potentially one of the most important reasons for being on the internet, it's vital to have regular, updated, relevant, engaging content. And although we have blogs on WordPress, on Blogger, you're getting more indexing from Google, you've got more integration with the Google Plus, which is the social layer, not a social network. You're out in the world rather than on an island. And I think although you can do your blogging there, and Jenny, like you just said, it's about blogging, not about a website, but it's also a place for you to have your about section. Who are you? Let people get to know you. You don't need to spend the time and the money and the effort on a WordPress website if all you're doing is sharing content and you want people to know about you. You know, on mine, I've done a little bit of coding that Jenny helped me with, because Jenny's a bit of a whiz with coding. And I've put some drop-down lists so that I can actually signpost people back to my other websites that have my sales pages, that have my opt-in forms, that have my membership programs on. But I think Blogger, I think people are not recognizing the effectiveness and the relevance and how much Blogger can actually help their business, their brand building and their community building and their visibility on the internet. And I think, although yes, I agree to a certain percentage that it is about having a blog, it's more about having content and relevant information and thinking about how it's going to spread out across to other people by hosting on Blogger versus hosting on WordPress. And I'm not saying WordPress is not a good place to host.
Can I just pick up on what you said there about the blog? I think what you were describing there is what I've heard described as a blog site, where the blog is a major part of it, but then you sort of have pages behind it with information about it and that sort of thing, but they're kind of backing up your blog and providing more information rather than being the main part of your website with the blog behind it. And that's what I meant, that what you've just described now is exactly what I meant when I actually said a blog, because to me a blog is the major page, major thing of it is your blog, but there's all sorts of about me pages there. There's maybe if you've got a book blog, for example, your front page would be the actual blog, but you'd have an about me page, you'd have reviews by genre, you'd have challenges and all kinds of things on the different pages. And that, to me, that's a blog site. And I think it's kind of a slight misinterpretation of how we're using the words sometimes, and we have to realise how I use a word isn't necessarily how you understand it, because I knew what I meant, and you sort of thought I meant literally just the blog page, but I actually meant exactly what you were talking about.
I think that is a really relevant point, because quite often we talk about something, you know, you talk to somebody and they say, I have a website, you know, I don't need anything else. But what they think is a website isn't what somebody else thinks a website is all about. And the same with what some people think of a blog, and a blog site is also completely different. And it's all about the perception. And that's why I wanted to go into more detail with that, so that we can really sort of get people thinking about their online presence. You know, where is your online presence? Yesterday I was looking on YouTube, and with the new One design, some people actually now are using YouTube for their online TV shows without creating a website that hosts their online TV shows where they embed their videos. And the whole layout and the design is brilliant for that on YouTube. You know, for other people, it's a bit of a concern. Well, what happens if Google suddenly takes my YouTube down? Well, that actually doesn't happen really for no reason, although it can, and it's always good to have a backup of your videos. But if people are more likely to be searching on YouTube and there aren't a lot of links and there's not a lot of visitors to your website, then why not run that as your online TV show, and especially integrated with Hangouts that people can view live on your YouTube channel. And Google like YouTube because they own YouTube, so you're adding to your social visibility. You know, and these are all things that I think we've got quite, not confused, not blasé, but people are not really thinking about what do you actually really need, and where is the best place for you to be, where is the best place that you can have the most visibility, you can create the most relevancy, and your target audience is most likely to come and find you. And sometimes having a WordPress or an HTML website is one of the hardest places to actually get visitors to it. Whereas, you know, some of the other things are a lot easier. It really depends on you. It depends on a lot of factors. And I think it is great that Jenny brought that up, that the words don't always actually mean what you think they mean.
I'll second that. For the reason that, you know, I'm the most technically challenged person on the team, and that was a really relevant point, Jenny, because, you know, to me, when you're talking blogger, I'm just thinking, well, that's a blog. I've just learned something that actually, that's like, I know what WordPress is, so that's good. But, you know, that was really, really relevant. And I think it's, you know, for non-technical people, it's getting your head around it all. And for, you know, and to really understand it, because to me, the Tinterweb's the Tinterweb, you know, it's all there, and it's kind of just the various different guises that it has. You know, I learned something yesterday. I learned that apparently if you post on Twitter, Google like Twitter more than they do Facebook, so they're more likely to rank you higher. See, Jenny's nodding her head. I didn't know that, so that's cool. So here's me, not been Mrs. Tweet King, been Mrs. Facebook Lady, is now going to be a bit more savvy on the old tweets.
I think Claire's brought up a brilliant point there about for the non-techie people. WordPress can be quite difficult for people to get into if they're not techie, whereas if you go onto Blogger and you want to set up a relatively simple blog, they actually have a template designer built in there where you can change the widths, several templates, your colours, insert images, all sorts yourself, and make it look really individual. With really, you don't need to know any HTML, CSS or anything. If you can click a few buttons and slide a few sliders and things, you can create a really individual looking site on Blogger. And that is one of the things that they've made a real point of having it that way, because it is intended to be somewhere where you can go and do the writing, do the blogging, whatever, without having to worry about the tech.
And you know what, Jenny, you're absolutely right, because whenever I am let loose on my own website to update it in any way, I always wreck the spacing and then I can never get it to look right. So I always end up, you know, I do it with kind of, oh, it'll be quicker than getting Ash to do it. I just want to change this wording. So I'm like, yeah, let's just do that. And then I do it and I look at it and I'm like, yeah, that looks rubbish. What have I done there? And then I go back in and try to change it. And yeah, it always ends up going back to Ash with a, Ash, can you make this look like presentable yesterday, please?
And that's a good point, Claire, because on Blogger, you can actually copy and paste and it looks the same when it gets onto Blogger as it did when you picked it up to copy it. On WordPress, you copy and paste, and because there's so much code and so much sort of background stuff, the formattings, you know, sometimes I pull my hair out on WordPress, and I'm pretty techie in comparison to a lot of people out there, and I pull my hair out because my PayPal button won't go in the middle, no matter what I do. Even if I use HTML code, it struggles and it doesn't like it when I look at it in one view and then I look at it in the other view and then I save it and it's gone back over here and the templates have all moved across the page. You know, you can do an awful lot more with WordPress than you can with Blogger. But Blogger is much simpler, and I think a lot of people have gone too over the top with their website. Some people have paid thousands of pounds to have a website designed that actually they don't need. There are some people who do, because you need the functionality. You know, if you've got buttons and forms and membership sites and all of that, you need something really different. But there are also people out there who are actually designing full websites using Blogger. There's some websites out there that people are designing for people that you would have no idea they were a Blogger website. They look like a top class £20,000 website. They really are. And can you hear my dog here? She's so crying, bless her heart.
It's making me sad.
I know, she's making me sad as well.
And I bet you she's giving you those eyes as well, isn't she?
Yeah, she's here on the chair with me, so she's all cuddled up.
Yes.
But she's just making... Okay, so... Oh. Ah, cool.
Hang on. Do we have a guest?
Right, can you hear me or not?
Yes.
Yeah.
Right, okay, I just got a message come up which reminded me of another Google Plus update that I shared yesterday, but I hadn't tried it out. And somebody said this only happens if there are four or more people in a Hangout. It doesn't. It happens with three people. You were talking, Claire. I think it was Claire that was talking at the time. I went to talk, and obviously the sound, for some reason, Google Hangouts thought I was trying to type, and they muted my mic. Automatically, I did nothing. And this is a new feature they've brought in, which actually obviously doesn't quite work, because the noise was my dog crying over the top of somebody else talking. It wasn't me trying to type, but it's obviously picking up when there's a background noise from the person who is not central and not doing the major talking, and it automatically said it had muted my mic. Now, when I looked up, the message is still up there. It says, sounds like you're typing, so we muted your mic. My mic, I don't think it was muted, because it wouldn't let me unmute. It was actually still unmuted. But the message is there. So this is something else that is new that will potentially help a lot of people who run group hangouts live on air. And when somebody is there typing in the background, which we often hear, and the host forgets to go and mute them, it will automatically mute them. So that's a feature to look out for, everybody. It's just popped up for me. Okay, let's go over to Claire for this week's money tip.
Well, everybody, I was just going to say that happened to me earlier when I first came on, because I was typing, so it obviously got that sus, but it didn't mute me either. So, don't know. But anyway, right, this week's money challenge. Okay. When my clients tell me how much they want to earn, I always test the figure, because we can be really good at just picking a number out of the air. How much do you want to earn this year? Well, I want to earn 120 grand. Great. Why do you want to earn 120 grand? Well, because, you know, that sounds like it's a nice amount of money, doesn't it? Yeah. But do you know how much it means that you're going to get every month? Do you know what sort of lifestyle that you want? Is it going to buy the lifestyle that you want? And so what I challenge you to do this week is re-look at, you know, we're kind of, you know, in well into Q2 now, and, you know, the year's motoring on and it's moving quickly. So what I want you to do is I want you to check out, what have you earned so far this year? Has it actually bought you the lifestyle that you wanted to have? Because the second thing I do is people will tell me what they want to earn, but then we also talk about, well, what is the business going to turn over? Because the turnover and the net profit of the business and you know, the income for you out of that business is also really key. Because a lot of the time it can be, well, you know, the lifestyle I want costs 120 grand, but my business is actually only turning over 100. So that probably means that I'm probably only going to get about 70 out of it after I've paid expenses and taxes and all that type of thing. So we can see that straight away there's a big gap and that somebody's going to end up getting let down somewhere and it's probably going to be you. So check out, how realistic is your earning figure? So many people just pick a number out of the air and then don't achieve it. And the reason they don't achieve it is quite simply because it doesn't mean anything to them. And if you watch my video for Motivational Monday a couple of weeks ago, it was about your why, and it was about, why are you doing what you're doing? You know, what's the big reason? What's the big why as to why you've done, you know, why you want to do what you want to do in your life? And actually, I think it was my tip for last week or the week before. I don't know. The weeks are like blending into another and I don't really know what day it is. But anyway, I digress. So check out, are you actually sort of trying to achieve a figure that really does do what you want to do in your life? And if you're not, maybe this is a great opportunity for you to do a little bit of shifting around here and to relook at things. So actually what you don't do is set yourself up to fall, because so many people in business go round in circles and don't actually go in a straight line and end up going round the roundabout 20 times because they haven't quite worked out which exit is they need to take. And that's because they haven't got a clear enough plan of where they want to go and they don't know what their strategy is. So for you to make sure that you do know where you're going, you don't keep driving around that roundabout going wrong and not getting anywhere and not achieving anything, get clear on what you're doing and get clear on what you want your income to be. Because believe me, when you do that, you're far more likely to actually achieve it. So let us know how you get on.
Speak to you. So are you saying if somebody has said they want, let's just say, £250,000 a year,
yeah,
and they, that would allow them to do everything they want to do,
yeah,
that they then will achieve that? Or are you saying that if somebody said, well, I want £250,000, but I'm not actually earning any of that, I'm not achieving my lifestyle, so therefore, wanting £250,000, I'm never going to get there, I'm going to set myself up to fail. Just explain that bit where...
No, what I'm saying is, when you've kind of come up with this figure that you want to earn, test it. Is it real? So did you just pick it out of the air? Because I always find that when somebody gives you a nice round number like that, they didn't actually do that part of their business plan very well. Because I've never met anyone that has a round figure on their accounts at the end of the year. So, you know, very few
people. It does occasionally happen, Claire.
Yeah, okay, occasionally. But there you go, that's the thing. It's very occasionally, and it's about being defined and being clear. So what I'm saying is, what is the figure that you want to earn and how much have you tested it? So if you actually sit down and said, right, every month I want to, you know, go out for a meal to this restaurant. You know, I want to do that four times a month. I want to go and have my hair done. I want to go and have a manicure. You know, I want to be able to take my children to this particular ballpark at least twice a month. You know, have you actually detailed what it costs to have the lifestyle that you want? And then does that marry up with what your business turns over? And yes, Carol, you are right. Is if somebody just says, oh, I want to earn 250 grand and that's that, well, no, they won't earn it because they haven't made it real for them to earn it, if that makes sense. Carol, you're muted.
I know. I'm struggling with a dog today. I was just looking at people's comments. Mike Herbert's left a comment to say that he hadn't had the opportunity to contribute. We were hoping you were coming live on air to join us, Mike, and that you would contribute here on air. And Mike has given us feedback to say, sorry, he's bored. So I do apologise that you're bored, Mike, and that you. But we really wanted you in the Hangout so we could chat to you about things and actually add more things and more things of interest to people. Marilyn has said, yes, WordPress can be a bit of a challenge at time. And Marilyn, we thought you were going to be on here as well, but you're not. So the two people that we wanted on here, they are commenting over on the event, but they haven't actually come and joined us in the room, sadly, which is a real shame. Okay, so that was the money challenge. Jenny, let's go over and talk about, you want to talk about book covers today.
Yeah, let me start off by asking you something. Do you judge a book by its cover?
It depends whether it's a book I'm judging by its cover, or whether it's the person that wrote the book, or whether it's a person that I'm judging.
No, never judge a book by its cover.
Okay, let me ask you the question a slightly different way. If you're browsing in a bookshop, or you're browsing around Amazon, do you then judge a book by its cover?
I think the thing is that we all tend to be attracted to pick up things that we like the look of, unless we have a particular thing in our heads that we know we are looking for a specific book and we actually don't care what it looks like. So I think from the question, I would tend to say no, but what I know that you're trying to ask, or what I'm assuming you're trying to ask there, is would I pick something up because I like the look of it over something that really didn't appeal to me at all?
Yes.
Yeah. Sorry, Jenny, I'm just an awkward one because, like, I know exactly what you're saying, but no, I don't judge books by the covers because you have to see what's inside.
So say you were looking for a book on, I don't know, starting a small business, and you found three books that appealed to you. Two of them have got great-looking covers, and all three books are self-published Kindle books. But the third cover, it looks like it's something someone kind of knocked together in about 30 seconds that has kind of no graphic design ability. Would that put you off the book?
No, because they might not be technical like me. They might be really quite clever in business, but absolutely appallingly crap at design. And that is me. In fact, if you looked at my ebooks on Amazon, you would probably say that.
So let's take this back, because poor old Jenny's
Jenny,
trying to say
yeah,
something.
I totally see what you're saying. If I wasn't me, then yes, I would pick one of the two that had got the good design covers, because I am also somebody that likes things to be aesthetically pleasing. So I'd be more attracted to those, but it probably would be the better book was the third one, and that's mine.
But that is, and I think that is the point, and we're going to let Jenny finish her point in a minute when Claire stops the punchlines. You know, especially if you're looking online, for instance, if you're on Amazon and you type in a topic that you're looking for, you get a whole list of books which you see the covers. You don't know exactly what you're looking for or who you're looking for. To me, and I know to a lot of people, the first thing that they are looking for is something that stands out to them, that they think, oh, that looks interesting. Let's go back to Jenny. Claire, let Jenny talk.
I have to say that the example I used there was an example I used because of where I'm talking. Now, I actually think that the book cover probably matters less for a non-fiction book than it does for a fiction book, because I think often often that a fiction book, it can, for an author, it can make the difference between whether someone picks up their book off the shelf or not. And it can say so much about the genre of your book. Now, I'm going to show you a couple of books that I've kind of picked randomly off my shelf, which you may or may not recognise. Do you know what genre they are from the cover? The first one.
I can't really see it very clearly. Is it like tables in front of it?
It is.
It looks like a little bit of a French sort of, I should be having a coffee, you know, by a chateau type thing. So I
Does that tell you anything about the kind of book it is?
I would anticipate that it's a story of some description.
You would anticipate that the novel is a story of some description?
Yeah. But maybe in continental Europe with a great little place to have a tea. It's to me that says France, Parisienne, bit of style. Yeah. Am I totally off the mark?
It's actually about a French restaurant. It's actually about the owners and family in a French restaurant in Dublin.
Ah, oh, well, there you go. Totally the wrong country, but the right nationality.
How about that one?
Well, you see, I know too much about that book. That to me is like, you know, sort of, it tells me that book cover to me, because I've read it, says that Silas walking down the corridor. Yeah, he's a bit scary.
Mm-hmm. So that is a good cover for the book because it portrays what is in the book.
Yes. Definitely.
Yeah. And that is exactly the point I'm making. Your cover needs to portray what's in the book, not the other way around. What does that say to you, Claire?
That says, lady on a mission that's not taking any crap from anybody, and she's got the revolver ready to go if you get on her nerves.
Perfect. You see, the cover's doing its job. It's telling you the kind of book it is. And that's what the book's That's what the book cover's job is. It's to entice you to look in the book, and so you know it's your kind of book. And that is the power of the cover.
Yeah, I really need to change the covers on my books. In fact, I'm not even going to tell you what they are.
I'm going to go and find them, Claire. And one final one for you, Claire.
You see, now that to me says Illuminati, secret society, it's all a bit twitchy trouser leg club, secret, we can't tell anyone, we're a bit corrupt.
Kind of. it's actually about the ancient, sort of the issues between the ancient races of witches and sorcerers who are separate to humans, and it's their history book.
Oh, I'd actually quite like to read that. What's it called?
It is called Dime Store Magic.
Oh, we might have to have a cheeky little look out for that.
So what we're saying here, Jenny, is that basically if you're writing a book, it's not all about just create some flash design. It's about think what message you want to give to the people that see your book cover.
Yeah, it doesn't need to be the most wonderfully graphically pleasing thing, or even it doesn't need to be an intricate cover, but it needs to make someone think, oh yes, it needs to match the message of your book, because people do, rightly or wrongly, a lot of people do judge a book by its cover. If you've got the most wonderful book about starting up in business, and your book cover on the men are looking through Amazon, it looks like it's about something totally different. It doesn't say to them this is about starting up business. It doesn't look as though, it doesn't give the impression that your book is going to be quality. Then that is when people judge a book by its cover. And it is important because so many people are visual, and sometimes if the cover isn't there, people don't get the, you don't get the chance for people to judge your book not by the cover. Having a good cover effectively gives you a chance to get to the second stage, that people actually read what your book is about. I think that's the key, that is the key thing.
So what would you say to people that are writing a book or they've written a book? How can they test their cover out other than the way you just did it there? You know, you showed us several covers and asked Claire, well, what do these covers mean to you? Or what do they depict to you? How would somebody who is creating their book work that out, what actually they need? You know, say they don't have thousands of pounds to go to a book cover designer and they're going to design their own, which a lot of people are doing now, especially with ebooks and Kindle books. How are they going to work out what design, other than test, because we always say test things, you know, you've got to test things out, but that's not necessarily going to work for a book, because they're not going to create the same book with different covers and put them on Amazon, because that doesn't quite work. So how are people are going to test these things out? How are they going to choose what they need on their book cover? How are they going to make sure that their book cover is going to appeal to the people they want it to appeal to?
Hey, so there's a couple of things people could do. The first thing would be have a good look around at what other covers are like in the genre that you're in, and decide whether you want to blend in or stand out. Because sometimes standing out, as long as you stand out good rather than stand out bad, is a way to go. But if you're going to stand out badly, make sure you do it really well, if you know what I mean. I think another way people could do it, depending on where they have conversations, if you have a Facebook page, you could put up a couple of draft designs on a Facebook page and ask your fans to vote on it. I actually saw one author, she actually held a contest held on Goodreads, the Book Lovers Social Network, and she actually held a competition, and the prize was that someone got their design put on her book. Now, she was someone who was actually on about her third or fourth book, and she was fairly well known. And she had hundreds of entrants because people wanted to see, she was posting them all for people to see and people to vote on. So that's a wonderful way to do it if you're someone that's got a little bit of a following. If you're members of a readers group, or you can show people ideas. I think another way you could do it, if you really have no idea, literally go onto places like the stock photography sites, get a few photographs that kind of represent what you want to do. You can download draft versions of them that have the watermarks across them, and ask your newsletter, ask people that you know, what portrays the right impression for your kind of book. You've spent no money there, you've spent little time preparing something that's not going to work, but you saved yourself a lot of time that you may have spent creating a cover that just doesn't work.
And I think that's that, you know, that is key. I've seen a lot of people that do that with logos and all sorts of things. They will put them up and get feedback from other people. Now, Marilyn said she's seen people ask for feedback on Facebook for different versions of covers. And it is, you know, it is about reaching out to your potential audience, because I think it's also important to think, if you're going to reach out to people, don't reach out to people that have no interest in that topic, because they are going to have a different sort of thought than the people that potentially are going to find that topic relevant and of interest to them, are going to have that in their mind and see something different. You know, it is all a little bit of a game in a way, because you don't always know, and some people might come back with feedback, it's their purely their personal personal design preference, but it actually doesn't say anything to them. So maybe something else to think about if you're designing a book cover or you're thinking of creating a book cover is don't necessarily tell, I mean, I know if you've got the title of the book there, but if you're thinking of images, maybe you can actually put one out without telling them what the book is about and say, what would this depict to you? So we'll also get feedback from people from the reverse way of doing it, that you're not just saying, okay, this is my book about this. Does this cover look as though it fits, or which cover is going to fit best? But you could also go out and say, this is a potential book cover I have. You know, take the title out. What do you think the book's about? Because that could really give some people coming back, like Claire when she was coming back with her ideas of what she thought the book was about. If people come back with ideas saying, well, I think this book is about world peace, and I think this book is about rocket science, and this book is about scientific methods of whatever, and your book is actually about flower building or flower arranging, you're going to know you're really not along the right lines. Because quite often we will look at things that we like personally, but actually nobody else likes them at all, and it doesn't portray what somebody else thinks. It's like with a logo. Quite often you can look at a logo and think, well, I really don't like that logo. Then you talk to the person whose logo it is, and they say, well, the logo has been done like that because this particular color depicts this, and this particular shape or symbol depicts this, and that was where it was all built from, because I have a very clever brand and logo designer who knows about these things. And yet to someone else, it might look completely, doesn't say that to me at all. So there's a lot of different things there, I think, that people should consider. Claire, what's the name of your books?
Not going to tell you.
I knew you'd say that. I was going to say, let's pull them up. Maybe they're over. Are they on Amazon?
Yeah, one of them is called, what are they called? This is great, isn't it? One of them is called, It's Not Rocket Science, 50 Tips to Something to, I think it's an Amazing Life or something like that.
Jenny, go and find that on Amazon.
And the other one's called Master Money in 30 Days.
And find that one as well. Right, we're going to find Claire's books and put them up on a screen.
No, really don't put them up, because the covers are really cheesy. Because yeah,
this is a really good thing though, Claire, because it's like, you know, you're in business, but you're open to learning. You're open for feedback.
Oh, God, yeah.
You know, so let's do it, and let's just see what some of the people who are watching, see if we can get some comments in for people to say whether that, because other people might think your book covers are great and perfect. They
and
might
cheesy
all think,
isn't necessarily bad.
So, and actually, you need to search the author as C.T. Marshall, because it's not on there as me.
Well, you are C.T. Marshall.
Yeah, I know, but it's just C.T. Marshall. It's not Claire Turner Marshall.
So how long have your books been up there on Amazon?
Oh, I don't know, about 3 weeks.
Oh, not very long. They're up to date.
No. I don't even know if I don't think I've even sold any yet.
So,
what were the cards again, Claire, please?
Do you know what? I'm going to have to look for you. Hang on.
Right, Claire, go and find your books.
I'll go find my books. Hold on.
Okay, Jenny, now Claire saying that has actually just brought up something else for me, and that I want to talk to you about with books. Claire's had them on Amazon for about 3 weeks, hasn't sold any. What should Claire have been doing since she put her books on Amazon to actually get some sales?
The first thing she should have been doing is telling people she's got her book on Amazon.
The
she hasn't mentioned
thing I should
it
be doing is remembering what they're called.
That would be a good start, Claire, actually. But hey, you can always put a link there.
This is a really, really important thing, people. If you write a book and you don't know what it's called, how on earth are you ever going to promote it to anybody? You know, I've got a book that is on Amazon. It only went up yesterday or the day before, and I haven't told anyone about it yet because there are some things that need changing, and we're waiting for Amazon to update it because there was a couple of typos that we missed before we put it up there. And it's called Find Your Niche, How to Stand Out in the Crowd. Now, I know the name of my book. Whether the book cover is a great cover or not, I've no idea. A few people, I did put it up a few weeks ago and say my book is coming onto Amazon, and I got some great comments back and people saying I really love the cover, and I went for it. I didn't do as much research and testing as perhaps I should. It's a small book that I actually wrote a few years ago and didn't do anything with, and I decided to start doing some things with the books that I have already written, and that one's gone up. But it is very, very important, because if you can't remember the name of your book, how on earth will anybody else remember it to pass it on to somebody who might potentially be interested in buying it from you?
That's very true.
Yeah.
And if my computer would stop thinking, I could actually get onto Amazon to try and... I'm just going to have a little look in my...
Because also something else that, I mean, I don't know that much about publishing on Kindle, because I am not putting my own books on Kindle. Someone else, very clever, is doing that for me. And I can see Jenny smiling there. But you have to think about a lot of things. It's not just your book cover. It's your name, as we've just found, because this conversation has brought us on to thinking about your name of your book. But also, how's somebody going to find your book? Have you thought about the keywords that people are going to be looking for when they go over to Amazon and type it in? You know.
Yeah, I did do that. That's why they're called what they're called, and I can't remember because I did the keyword search.
So you did a keyword search, and then you
did the keyword
as your book title.
Yeah, I'm just going to smash my Apple in a minute, because now it won't load me back to where I was, and it's starting to drive me mad.
So,
Claire, can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
I use the T Marshall. I use C dot T dot Marshall. Do you have spaces or no spaces?
Spaces, I think. C space T space Marshall.
Because it's one thing to think about when if you're using initials when in your author name.
Yeah.
If you put Claire Turner Marshall, no one's going to misdo that. Whereas if you put CT Marshall, some people will search CT with no space Marshall. Some will search C space T Marshall. Some will search C dot space T dot Marshall. And they actually don't necessarily come up when you do searches on Amazon with the variations of your name. So you need to be quite careful with that sort of thing.
Okay. Right, hang on. If I go into my Amazon, it should tell me somewhere in there what my books are, shouldn't it?
It better I do, yeah.
Right, hang
according on. According to my search, I can't find a CT Marshall.
Hang on. Do you think it will be under Manage My Kindle?
No, you to get into your Amazon publishing, you need to go down to the bottom and click on the self-publish with Kindle and go into the KPD
publishing
background bit.
And you know, if my computer would start baseballing!
So, did you put your books onto Kindle yourself, Claire, or had somebody else done that for you?
No, I managed to do that all on my own. Well, actually, I'm not going to lie. I went on a webinar that taught me how to do it.
Okay, so that you are your publisher.
I am. I did put them on there myself.
And is there any reason why you haven't blasted it out to everybody that you have put your books on Amazon for 3 weeks ago?
Because I think the covers are rubbish.
So if you think the covers are rubbish and you've put your book on Amazon, why did you put your books on Amazon with rubbish covers that you don't like? Why didn't you test your covers and ask some people and wait until you thought they were right? Because sort of what's going around in my head here is, if you have put a book, then potentially you have an income stream. You have something there of interest to people. But if nobody knows it's there, if you don't like what you've put up there, was that a good investment of your time to get it up there in the first place? Or should you maybe have, and this is just me asking questions, it's not me having a go at anybody, this is sharing questions, and hopefully the dog's not too loud. Should you have potentially done more planning before putting it up there?
Yes, Carol.
Is that one of yours, Claire?
Hang on, I can't.
How to Master Money, 30 Steps.
Yeah, that's me! Have you found it?
Yes, it's on screen share, Claire.
Oh, hang on, it's all right. I can see it just about. Yeah,
Jenny,
that's
me. Can you maximise the screen at all, Jenny? Can we get a bigger picture of that book cover?
That's it, that's me.
Is that bigger?
It's not very big, but that's it. It's coming a little bit bigger now. So basically what I can see is How to Master Money, 30 Steps. Yep, we're getting, that's better. And there's a house, there's some dollar signs, and there's two people looking incredibly happy. Now, you know, I don't necessarily find that rubbish. It does look to me a bit like a cover that lots of other people have picked up from somewhere.
Yeah.
Doesn't look original. It doesn't look like a cover. It's sort of, for me, and this is just my honest opinion.
Yeah, please be.
Looks like a cover that I have seen on a lot of different books.
Okay, so what would you do differently then?
Well, let's get Jenny's opinion of the cover.
Jenny,
first.
Come on, tell us what you think, Jenny.
Okay, I think there's nothing exactly wrong with the cover, but like Carol says, I've seen it before.
Yeah, it doesn't stand out.
It doesn't stand out. It looks exactly like a book with 30 steps of how to master money. I could quite easily buy that off several different people. There's nothing that makes it pop out to me that it's by you.
So what would you do differently then?
Okay, Marilyn's saying need a better photo. I'm not quite sure what Marilyn means by need a better photo. She does say she loves the cover. Oh no, I love the cover. Was that for Claire's or for mine, Marilyn? Just remembered that because that was a while ago. I just think that, like I say, I'm looking at that and it looks like a marketing cover that I would see on a website. I would see it on all sorts of things. And I don't think it's a bad cover. I think it does say what is in the book.
Yeah, but it doesn't stand out, does it?
It doesn't stand out. There is nothing there that I haven't seen before that's going to pull my eyes and think, this is different.
Jenny, do you know anybody or do you design book covers?
I don't design book covers myself, nor Claire, but I do know a few people who do.
And are they people that can, like, think outside the box and just do it and not like, yeah, listen to me?
I would say people would always want input from you, Claire.
Yeah, I know that, and I'm kind of joking.
Yes,
yeah, I know that.
Yeah,
but
they are people
it's something
who
think that's going to make it quirky and a bit different.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, take a look at things like one book cover that I think is pretty ugly, but it's obviously been designed with a specific reason. It is Randy Gage's Risky is the New Safe. It's not the sort of cover that you would expect, but it grabs your attention. Guy Kawasaki's covers for the APE book, it's ugly, it's horrible, but it grabs your attention.
It grabs your attention, exactly, and that is what you need to do. You need to stand out from the crowd.
Okay. Jenny, can you put me in touch with your book designing cover people, please?
Marilyn's putting in, it looks like something a real estate agent or financial planner who took the first photo they found.
Yeah, that, you know what, Marilyn, I totally agree with you 100%. That's what I thought when I saw it.
So basically, it's all about, I mean, that cover isn't that bad that you can't tell people, I have a book on Amazon. You know, people that know you are not going to think, I'm not going to read this book because of the cover. Like you said, you don't judge a book by the cover.
No,
but perhaps look at getting new covers. Something that I often wonder about is, and something I tend to be, and I think I got it from my mum, I'm very much about keeping my branding, my colour schemes, and sort of my designs the same, no matter what I'm doing. And like, the new book that's just gone up onto Amazon, the cover is very similar to my G+ Hangout Success Program book and CD covers. And it's the same color scheme. It's the same text that I've used on it. And then I've used a different image in the middle. And mine is actually not got I don't know if you can find mine, Jenny, because I'd be interested to see people's feedback on mine, because maybe mine's totally rubbish. But, you know, maybe it's about looking at your branding as well and your own colour schemes and finding something that fits with the colour schemes as well as fitting with the actual title and description and content of the book.
Okay, yeah, point taken. Thanks, ladies.
And something
the
else.
The content is great. I highly recommend what's in it. I'm just not always the best at the cover.
There you go, Carol. Okay.
There we go. You need to, there you go. That's, you know.
Like, Nessie, I like that. That's really cool.
You see, that is my book cover for Find Your Niche.
Like that.
Stand out in the crowd, and it is, but it's very simplistic. There's no image on there or anything. It's my branding, and I, for me, the reason I picked the arrows in the middle was that, and the out as a big word at the bottom. That was my way of saying, you know, finding your niche is about standing out in the crowd. So I was thinking about, and I'm not a designer by any means at all, you know. That was what I was trying to depict, was something that was very clean, very clear, and just stood out, and that those images potentially would stand out to people as what the book is about. Whether I've done it and it works or not, I have no idea, but that's my cover.
Did you design that yourself?
Yeah.
You see, I just wouldn't even contemplate doing that, because I just would spend hours on it, and it would be a completely unproductive use of time for me. You know what, I'd get it looking really good, and then I'd wreck it, and then I'd get really harassed with myself, and like potentially that would cause me to lose my temper, and I don't do that anymore. So we avoid anything that would even possibly get me, you know, to lose my temper, because no. No.
So, but I think, you know, I mean, I don't know about the people that are watching. I know Marilyn has been enjoying it because she's been putting lots of comments in and following us along. And Marilyn, next time, please come on. Even if you're late, you are always welcome to come and join us on the Hangout. Mike Herberts, if you happen to be listening now, which I don't think you will be if you were bored after 30 minutes, but I would love to have you on because I know you have a ton of really great stuff to share with people. So I'm actually going to talk to Mike off air afterwards and see if I can persuade him to come and join us on one of the Take a Break shows, maybe as our actual invited guest. Anybody else that would like to come and join us anytime, you know, we are always here every Monday, but we're always happy to have people as a special invited guest if you've got something specific you want to share with people. We love people to just hop on and come on as part of the panel and ask your own questions about the topics we're discussing. People, if you have something that you've got some hints and tips and you think, well, I would like to take part in that, come on. We're also, you know, we'd be quite happy to have people come on more regularly as well. You don't have to just hop on once. Or if you've got questions that you, business questions, something that you're finding really challenging and you want to come on and ask a business question. Maybe you want to ask Claire something specific about money, and we'll do a session where we'll have several people coming on really digging into what Claire does and getting her, putting her on the spot really in depth. Maybe we can do that if you've got questions about writing a book, you've got questions about being an author, you've got questions about getting your book on Kindle, doing a virtual book tour, and we'll delve right in and we will actually grill Jenny with you, with us on the Hangout. These Hangouts are not just about us sitting here and presenting out to you. These Hangouts are for you. And we would be more than happy to have anybody come on board and actually join us in a Hangout as well. So please do tell me if you'd like invites for a later date. Tell me whether you want to come on as a special guest and you have something specific you want to share on a topic that you're a specialist in, or whether you'd like to come on and ask questions. And if you'd like to come and ask questions, what topic would you like to ask a question about so that we can put you on the right show at the right time? But we'd love to have you with us. So we're up to the top of the hour, so we're going to finish there. I think that was I enjoyed the second part much more than the first part. I actually loved that, talking about the books and actually showing some real examples and looking and sort of giving the help to each other and getting the feedback from people and starting the cogs ticking on what you can think about and what you should think about and how you can get things that really work for you. So, Jenny, any last minute things you'd like to share?
I think I'd like to say, don't get too hung up on the on your cover. Get a good enough cover. Get your book out there. And when it's on Kindle, please tell people you've published it. Because if people don't know it's there, you won't sell any.
That's a good tip. I haven't told too many people yet, like I say, because I'm waiting for the edit to update itself, and then I'm going to take it out there. So, Claire, start promoting your
books at the moment.
When I have made my covers look nicer, I shall promote my book.
No, Claire, good enough. It's up there. You have published them. They are live on Amazon.
Yeah, they are.
Yes, so promote them now. You can sort your cover and change it later, but get the word out that you have a great book. Tell people what it's about. Tell them why they want to spend £6 on a Kindle book, which for me, I'm not quite sure that that's the right price level, but hey, that's your choice on that, and I might be completely wrong. But get it out there. Tell people about it and see what happens.
There is a logic behind why it's priced at that, because the webinar that I went on said that the best price points were between $2.97 and $8.97. And because there's a hell of a lot of content in that book, that's why I went for the higher price and I went for the $8.97. So that's the conversion. So, yes. It might seem quite expensive, but believe me, that book will save you thousands.
And hopefully you've put that in your description.
Yes.
And hopefully you have given the book, or you have got some people that have downloaded for free that have done some reviews on your book as well. And if not, that's the next step. But we're not going to go into it because we're 6:05 and we're about to go. So any last words from you, Claire?
Now just, you know, learn from feedback from other people and be awesome.
Cool stuff. So we hope to see you next week. I'm Carol Dodsley, better known as the G+ How To Girl, with Claire Turner Marshall and Jenny Braithwaite, and we'll see you at the same time next